Good evening and welcome to tonight's Cornwall and Area Chamber of Commerce All Candidates Debate, the only televised debate for our riding on TVCOGECO. I'm your moderator, Dan Allaire. A little bit of housekeeping before we begin this evening, but for those of you undecided, over the next 90 minutes, you'll get to know all four local candidates, and hopefully come October 19th, Election Day, you can go and make an informed decision, and we hope to help you along that journey here this evening. Housekeeping for this evening: each candidate positioned at random, numbers were drawn before the broadcast. We'll have a two-minute opening statement, followed by questions from myself, the moderator, prepared by the Chamber of Commerce. And each candidate will get a minute to respond, followed by a two-minute scrum for each of the moderator's questions. A little bit later on this evening, we will go to the floor here. Audience members will have 30 seconds to ask a question to a specific candidate. They will then have a minute to respond, and we'll try and get through as many of those as possible. So thank you for joining us, and hopefully tonight you find our debate very informative to help you out on October 19th. So we begin drawing the number one spot, our NDP candidate, Patrick Berger.
So thank you all for coming here tonight. My name is Patrick Berger. Je suis fier d'être ici ce soir comme candidat pour l'NPD, et je suis ici ce soir pour vous demander à voter pour le NPD. In 2011, all the media and the pundits were saying that it was a two-horse race between the Harper Conservatives and the Ignatieff Liberals. The NDP was polling third up until a week before election. As you know what happened, we had our spectacular result that put us into the House of Commons as the official opposition. The strength of the NDP throughout this campaign shows that we have a real alternative to the revolving door that we have in Ottawa between the Conservatives and the Liberals. The Conservatives are going to try to scare you into voting for them, and the Liberals are going to try to charm you with their usual showmanship. But the NDP is going to act. We will give you action on things like secret trade deals, like the TPP, as flawed as it is. We're going to give you action on restoring services and basic respect to our veterans. We're going to give you action on restoring door-to-door mail delivery. We're going to give you action on restoring funding to the CBC et pour Radio-Canada. So on October 19th, when you have that pencil in your hand and that little piece of paper in front of you, just remember that you have the power to change things finally in Ottawa, change them for good. And you know that when you put that X beside the NDP, you will get a government that will do what it says that it will do. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Berger. Our PC candidate, Mr. Guy Lozo.
Good evening, everyone. Bonjour, tout le monde. Merci pour votre présence ici ce soir. In my 11 years as your Member of Parliament, it has been an honor to serve you, and I want to continue to do so. Here are some key facts about our government's record. Federal taxes are at their lowest level in 50 years. Canada's economy is among the strongest in the G7. We have created 1.3 million net new jobs in Canada since the start of the global economic recession in 2008. Locally, we've been able to bring 217 high-paying Service Canada jobs to Cornwall with a payroll of between $12 and $15 million per year. We have also funded projects totaling somewhere between $175 and $200 million, including the new low-level bridge, gas tax funding for local road and bridge repairs, the $15 million RCMP headquarters, and $37 million for wastewater treatment facilities in Cornwall, Morrisburg, and Iroquois. My constituency office has assisted 1,400 local families to receive $11 million in tax refunds through the disability tax credit. We've assisted 58,000 constituents to acquire a passport. We've assisted over 20,000 constituents in person each and every year with other government-related issues. We have been able to accomplish all this during the worst global recession in 70 years and without raising your taxes. In fact, we have lowered your taxes for seniors, families, and businesses to their lowest level in 50 years. We have also cut the GST from 7% to 5%. Reduced personal income taxes for a family of four to $6,600, and have introduced income splitting for seniors and families. Ladies and gentlemen, our balanced low-tax approach is working. Thank you. Merci.
Thank you, Mr. Lauzon. Your Liberal candidate, Bernadette Clément.
Bonsoir. This election comes at a crucial time for our country. We all know this, and people are paying attention. We're fortunate in Canada, but we have challenges too. I've experienced this firsthand in my 24 years of work as a legal clinic lawyer, helping low-income persons of Stormont, Dundas, Glengarry with the many problems that they face. And in my 9 years on City Council, I have felt the need of a community that wants to do more, that really wants to do better. People here in SDSG want their children to do as well or better than they did. They want their children to prosper here or come back here to raise their children. But do people really believe that will happen? You have surely heard and seen the ads that say that Mr. Trudeau is not ready. But this is not true. He is ready, and he has the best plan for our future and the future of our children. You may hear tonight that the provincial Liberals and the federal Liberals are one and the same, but this is not true. The federal Liberal plan calls for true federal leadership, which means a prime minister who will meet regularly with all premiers, no matter their political stripe. You may hear tonight that we should be afraid of investing in infrastructure right now and that this is not good for our economy, but this is not true. The Liberal Party stands apart from the others in that it offers a distinct vision for this country. We are clear and transparent about proposing a modest deficit over the next 3 years to invest in smart, long-term infrastructure that will help kickstart our economy. The Liberal plan has a comprehensive, caring approach with a focus on families and growth. This takes new leadership from a new generation that is ready to lead, ready to bring the message of this riding, its hopes and its challenges to Ottawa. Le Canada a besoin d'un nouveau leadership plus ouvert, plus transparent, qui n'a pas peur d'avoir une vision plus large et plus équitable pour notre société. Transparent, open, unafraid of sitting down with premiers, municipalities, farmers, a big, bold country like ours works best when we talk to one another. Merci.
Thank you, Ms. Clément. Next up, your Green Party candidate, Elaine Kennedy.
Mr. Moderator, fellow candidates, ladies and gentlemen. I came to this area in 1972, and I taught at CCVS and St. Lawrence High School. I guess I'm known as the Hat Lady, and if you see a hat being worn around Cornwall, there's a good chance it's me. I live just north of St. Andrews. I have 25 acres of forested area. I'm a rural landowner, not a farmer, a rural landowner. And when I retired in 1995, I started working with environmental groups to improve the quality of the environment around this area. In my introduction and closing, I would like to tell you about the Green Party and my philosophy. Green Party candidates who are elected promised to set the standard for transparency and accountability. We were the first to scan all original receipts and post all expenses on our website. Conduct ourselves respectfully in the House of Commons through our commitment to never heckle. Practice high road politics, never using attacks on individuals, but sticking to issues in debate. Work hard, placing the interests of our constituents and of Canada above those of our party. Be the only party with a policy of no whipped votes. Strive to find common ground with other parties, working across party lines in the public interest. I'm not going to make long comments about policies right now, but in answering your questions, tell you what we want to do when elected about the issues that concern you. Quoique je parle mauvais français, j'essaierai de répondre aux questions en français. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Kennedy. Just a friendly reminder, questions from the moderator won't be very long. Each candidate will get 1 minute to answer the question, and then following all 4 minute-long responses, we'll open the floor up to debate. The first question this evening comes out of the Chamber of Commerce Ontario report, Federal Priorities for the Ontario Economy. The Federal Economic Development Agency for Southern Ontario, or FedDev Ontario, has set a budget for the province at $17.61 per capita, compared to $37.16 per capita for Quebec. A clear and significant inequity. What will you do to ensure that the FedDev funding is distributed on a more equitable basis? And with this one, for the minute-long response, we'll begin with Mr. Lauzon.
Th- Thank you very much, Dan, for the question. The FedDev is doing a lot of good work, especially in Eastern Ontario. We also have a Federal Development Fund Eastern Ontario Training Board, and we invest $10 million per year into the Eastern Ontario Training Plan. And we promote and help businesses begin and expand here in Eastern Ontario. And one of the ways we do it is with some small startup funds, but more importantly, we do it with some loans. We want to cooperate with the provinces. The problem is that a lot of times the provinces want to do their own thing. And when you're trying to get 10 provinces on side to do a certain plan, we have the same challenges when we are in agriculture, education, healthcare. It's hard to get all the provinces on the same page. But listen, we're the party of jobs. We want to create jobs. FedDev creates jobs. We will cooperate any way we can. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Lozo. Ms. Klima.
Mr. Harper struggles with the idea of meeting with premiers, and this question deals directly with sitting down with provinces to figure what is most equitable for all provinces. And so the answer to that is we have to sit down, and a federal leader needs to be able to do that not just once a year or once every 2 years. You have to do that regularly. So this kind of inequity can be resolved through discussion. Our healthcare situation is similar. We have provinces that are getting per capita, and some provinces are getting more than others as a result. And so we need to sit down with our provinces. And FedDev does do good work, and we'll need to make sure that we talk to them.
Thank you, Ms. Claymont. Ms. Kennedy?
I'm going to admit right off the bat I haven't got a clue about FedDev funding. However, one of the things that the Green Party believes in is discussions with all the parties. We want to set up what we call a Council of Canadian Governments, in which we work with federal, provincial, local representatives, First Nations, Métis, Inuit, to discuss issues that affect all of us, that go across the Constitution, that have a little bit here and a little bit there, and we need to talk. Communications is one of the key things, and we believe in talking to each other and not staying in our little isolated areas.
Thank you, Ms. Kennedy. Mr. Berger.
So this is definitely a result of Mr. Harper not being able to discuss or talk to the premiers. Again, there's been no first minister's conferences pretty much since Mr. Harper has been in office. And this, again, is a sign of their short-term kind of thinking. What they're doing here is they're buying Quebec off as opposed to trying to build bridges with Quebec, trying to basically get Quebec to buy into Canada. So again, this is short-term thinking. This is not going to work in the long run, and it's not fair to provinces like Ontario that end up on the losing end of this.
Thank you, Mr. Berger. So now the floor is open for the next couple of minutes.
Healthcare is a good one. So right now the health accord has expired, and what we have is a situation where Ontario, which has an older population than other provinces, than Alberta for example, is funded per capita, and yet we have an aging population that creates more of an impact on our healthcare, more of a cost. And so we need to be able to sit down with the Prime Minister and have some federal leadership on that issue. And this kind of thing is an example of that, an example of a prime minister who does not sit, talk with premiers on a regular basis to deal with issues like the FedDev funding and like healthcare.
It's interesting that my colleague brings up healthcare. I think that's an excellent topic for me to discuss, because the former government, her government, actually gutted healthcare to the tune of $25 billion here in Ontario. Since that time, since we formed government 9 years ago, we've increased healthcare funding 70%. 70% increase in 9 years in healthcare funding. We've increased it 6% per year, and we plan to continue to do that. We now distribute funds on a per capita basis. When it gets back to your FedDev, the original question was about FedDev. We cooperate, our federal. We are cousins. We cooperate on many projects right here in this riding. We've created some wonderful, wonderful enterprises who've gone on and employed lots of people because the province and the feds cooperate with seed funding. We get them up and running. We help with the training. First thing you know, they're hiring more and more people. So I think we cooperate excellently with the province. We don't have to have a gong show like the former prime minister used to have with these. You remember these first ministers' conferences? All kinds of noise, and everybody was trying to get more. What our Prime Minister does is he deals in a methodical, practical way, business person to business person, and he deals with them the way it should be done. Thank you.
The irony of this is that both Liberal and Conservative governments have been cutting healthcare for decades now. And one of the big things about the kinds of figures that our Conservatives like to give is that it looks like healthcare funding has gone up. If you're slashing the budget all over the place everywhere else, sure, then, you know, percentage-wise, it looks like there's more money there. But in fact, when you look at the graphs and you see how healthcare, which was once 50% federally funded and is now lower than 20% federally funded, the provinces have to pay 80%.
Sure. That's time for this one. Our next question. With respect to infrastructure funding as it relates to your role, regional issues include both the Highway 138 and the revitalization of Cornwall's international crossing now that the old bridge is currently being dismantled. What steps will you take to ensure that adequate funding for both these projects will be put in place? And on this one here, we begin with Ms. Klima.
My favorite question is infrastructure. This is where the Liberal Party stands apart from the other parties. We want to invest right now in infrastructure spending, particularly in the area of transportation corridors. And that is incredibly important for this riding. What we do here is we have a great geographic location. It's golden. We're on the border of Quebec. We're on the border with the US. We have distribution centers. We have storage facilities. And we have agricultural products that need to make it out to market. And so all of that funding that will happen right away, that infrastructure investment, will help this riding in particular, including our Highway 138, which is our healthcare lifeline. And so a Liberal government will invest right now, not 2, 3, 4 years from now, but right now when those investments are needed to kickstart our economy.
Thank you, Ms. Clement. Ms. Kennedy.
The Green Party believes also in supporting local infrastructure, but at the same time, we believe that when you have your local infrastructure, you must use local people for the jobs that are involved, and at the same time, use local people in apprenticeship situations or in training situations so that you are improving both the education and the job opportunities of local people. We believe that one point of the GST should be go to municipalities for infrastructure, and when this happens, we want it to be not stopped from using local people by some of the legislation that has happened about the fact that you can't use local companies. You have to put out and take the lowest bid. We believe in local people being supported with local jobs.
Thank you, Ms. Kennedy. Mr. Berger.
So one of the strange things about being involved in these debates is you hear the other candidates say things that are kind of strange. The Liberal Party does not stand apart in having an infrastructure project. We have the same thing. We have budgeted $3 billion over the 4 years of a first mandate. It's a fully costed platform. There will be no going into deficit for it, and it will create a balanced budget. So as the MP, I'll make sure that the monies that are being allocated for the federal infrastructure projects do go to the projects that the municipalities have prioritized and what they feel is where the money should go.
Thank you, Mr. Berger. Mr. Lauzon.
Thank you. I think it's interesting the infrastructure comes up, and my colleague spoke to that, because some of you probably saw an article by Andrew Coyne in last week's Ottawa Citizen, and just a few quotes from him. He says, the title is, "All is not as it seems in the Grits Investment Plan, but all is not just as it looks in the Liberal Plan. In fact, almost nothing is. Whatever else the Liberal Plan is about, it's not about infrastructure. The notion that this is going to have any discernible impact on the economy is so fantastic it could only have been cooked up in a political strategist meeting. In other words, it's all for show." Roughly speaking, he ends the article by saying, roughly speaking, the NDP would raise spending and taxes by about $10 billion annually each. The Liberals would raise the spending by $15 billion and taxes by $5 billion. Folks, Highway 138 needs some work, and we would be willing to cooperate in any way that we would seem reasonable, providing the province wanted to cooperate. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Lauzon. The floor is now open.
We do stand apart as a Liberal Party. This is not just $3 billion investment. This is $10 billion for the next 3 years. And provinces, relying on provinces and municipalities is a tough go. We actually need a federal partner at the table right now, not 3 years from now, not 4 years from now. This is the most significant investment in infrastructure that will help this riding and the economy of this riding. It'll help with jobs, but it'll help. Look at our Benson Center and our wastewater treatment plant. Those were investments that were made during a recession in 2008, and they made this community feel strong and competent and did help to kickstart our economy. So I would argue that this does work and that the Liberal Party does stand apart in that we want to do it right now and we want to put significant investments in smart, long-term infrastructure that will help people of this riding.
This is classic Liberal short-term thinking. This is the same kind of thinking that's put us in this climate change situation where the Liberals with all flash signed Kyoto and then did nothing to implement it. So we have the same thing here, that they're going to go into these massive deficits for these infrastructure projects. Why do we have to go into a deficit? We've got it all balanced. We've got it all costed out. It's not necessary to have people in the future have to pay for our economic advance now. We can live within our means, and we can get the projects done that need to get done.
They say, continuing with, this is some great quotes in this article by Andrew Coyne. He says, committing the party to spend $145 billion over the next 4 years, on top of a $1.75 trillion spring budget, had already pledged the federal government to spend over the same period. That is about all it took, but all is not as it looks in the Liberal plan. They want to increase spending 13% over a $1.75 trillion budget. You're talking about a $10 billion deficit. It's going to be a $100 billion deficit at that rate.
That's not what I said.
I'd also like to remind everyone to be respectful of the candidates this evening. We're here to have a discussion. Thank you. Our next question. It wasn't that long ago many eyebrows were raised when chemical tanks were brought to Cornwall. This issue deals with communication. The federal government owns a considerable amount of land in Cornwall. What will you do to ensure that the public is informed in advance of any activity related to the lease, sale, or development of any federal land? And in this one here, we'll begin with Ms. Kennedy.
Well, back to communications. And I think one of the things that we have to realize is that when you communicate, you must be able to communicate between departments. And it seems that whether it's at provincial level, which I don't know a lot about, or federal level, it seems that departments don't talk to each other. They also don't talk to the MPs about issues that are in their particular riding. Like, we should know what's happening in our riding on the federal lands from the federal people. We should know what's happening in the provincial lands from our provincial people. We need to have communications, and we need to be able to talk to each other without a problem of what my party says is this and what your party says is that, and we can't get along. We need to communicate, find what is best for on an issue for the people of our riding, and then work on it.
Thank you, Ms. Kennedy. Mr. Berger.
So this goes into the culture of secrecy that we see with the Harper government, to the point of paranoia that they have, where they vet the attendees at their own events, where they vet the media, and the media is allowed to ask one question, maybe if Mr. Harper, you know, feels like answering it. One of the issues with these toxic tanks, there's two possible things that happen. First off, that the secrecy was so much that Mr. Lauzon didn't even know that this was going to happen, which is definitely not the sign of a good government. Or he might have known about it, but was sworn to secrecy, so couldn't say anything to his own constituents and to his own city. So this kind of thing has to go. We need to have an open, tolerant government with the kind of democratic culture we have within the NDP. And of course, an NDP MP would be able to, you know, intervene in these situations and know what its own government was planning to do.
Thank you, Mr. Berger. Mr. Lauzon.
I think the chamber for that question. Let me put the facts on the table. The city was contacted in February 2013 by the lessee requesting information regarding the possibility of land in Cornwall that could support liquid storage with at least 6,500,000 liters of storage capacity. The city put the lessee in contact with the harbor master at the port. Lease negotiations were conducted in the summer of 2013, including the completion of an environmental effects determination of the proposed project. On June 3rd, 2013, the lessee contacted the city, advising the city of the proposed lease agreement with details of the construction of the liquid storage capacity tanks as originally identified in February 2013. The obvious difficulty is the tenant is not doing anything improper, illegal, and in fact, there is a need for the product in Eastern Ontario.
Thank you, Mr. Lauzon. Ms. Clément.
We have great hopes and plans for our waterfront. It is part of how we define ourselves as a community. And one of the most disappointing files for our area was that arrival of those chemical tanks on our waterfront. You know, an MP should be aware of those hopes and plans for our waterfront. An MP should be in touch with federal government departments to say, on these files, I want to be told ahead of time when there are significant projects. Transport Canada is a major landowner in this area. So our MP should be saying to Transport Canada 10 years ago, I want to be copied on projects that affect lands owned by Transport Canada because they impact on our community. And what about the duty to consult with Akwesasne? There is a duty to consult with Akwesasne on matters concerning our waterfront. This was not done, and Akwesasne had to actually take this matter to court. We need an MP who's going to be able to secure meetings with ministers when things go wrong. If the community rises up and says, we don't want those tanks, what happened here? We want you to talk to a minister. We need an MP who's going to be able to secure those meetings. So this is a failure on the part of this current government, a disappointing file for all people living in this area.
Open.
I'll tell you where the failure is on this file. Some councillors made the decision about this issue without even knowing how tall the tanks were or what the floor plan was for the tanks. That if I was a resident of Cornwall, I would be very disappointed that the councillor who made the didn't know. We talk about communication and transparency. How come the councillor who's to my left didn't know that in June the 3rd that they were approached and looking for a lessee? How come
please
that?
Please let the candidate speak.
This is not a council issue. This is a federal government issue.
If the city isn't responsible for their waterfront and they're communicated by the lessee on June the 3rd and we hear about it in January, a year later, and now we've offered the harbor to the city twice. Twice we offered this, the whole harbor to the city free 7 years ago and again 15 months ago. Why are you not proposing that you take the harbor and the tanks?
This is a federal government failure. It's the land is owned by the federal government,
it's
and you should have been aware.
Asking, free.
You should have been aware that this project was taking place.
Bernadette,
and
it's
now
free.
We
you
have to
have
deal
it.
With it. Now we're dealing with a port divestiture program, and so Council and Mohawk Council of Akwesasne, Council of Cornwall, they're working now with the federal government. Way late, but we're trying to figure out now how to get control of this port.
Transport Canada will sign that port over today. Today. Do you want it? Do you want it?
Sign.
Somehow we're forgetting the chemicals on the waterfront.
So we'll close that one there, and we will pause for a quick break. As a reminder, you're watching the Chamber of Commerce All Candidates Debate on TVCOGECO. We'll be right back. And welcome back, everyone, to the Chamber of Commerce All Candidates Debate on TVCOGECO. A reminder, we have three more questions from the moderator. Again, all candidates will get their 1 minute to respond. Opened after with a two-minute debate, we have three more of those questions. We'll take another commercial break after that, and then we'll return with questions from the floor here for those in attendance at the Civic Complex. Next question. All political parties have committed to reducing the small business tax, and yet it doesn't really appear to be an immediate priority. Is it a priority for you? And on this one, we'll begin with Mr. Berger.
Well, it is a priority for us. We're planning to reduce the small business tax as soon as we get into power. So we will probably have that in place at the end of the first year of a mandate. Mr. Mulcair has been clear about that on the times that he's been interviewed about that. We know that this is an important measure to kickstart the economy. 80% of jobs in Canada are created in the small business sector. And so it is a major priority for us. We won't be delaying as long as the Conservatives are saying that they will, that they'll wait several years to get this down to 9%. We're going to move much faster than that.
Thank you, Mr. Berger. Mr. Lozo.
Thank you very much. Mr. Moderator, as a matter of fact, we're the government that took over in 2006 and reduced the business tax from 13% to 11%, like a previous government had promised to do. We did that in 2006 and 2007. We are planning to lower it even further from 11% down to 9% over the next 2 years. And I tell you why we do that. We know darn well, if we put more money in businesses' pockets, businesses, small businesses or large businesses, don't want to pay tax. So what do they do with any money that they have extra? They reinvest it in their business. The lower we put taxes down, the more jobs we create, as proven by the last 7 years, 1.3 million new jobs as a result of a low-tax program.
Thank you, Mr. Lozo. Ms. Clément.
There are more than 1.3 million people who need jobs, by the way, sir. Now, in terms of the question, yes, we will be reducing the business rate, definitely from 11 to 9%, and we want to also invest in innovation and incubation. So small businesses need help with innovation, research, technology, and so a Liberal Party would want to invest in that sector. We'd also want to invest in agribusiness. So there are small agricultural businesses as well that need help with marketing and research. The SDG Agri-Food Report confirmed that, and so we want to invest not only by reducing the business rate, but also investing to make sure that small businesses and entrepreneurs have access to marketing and research ability to make sure that their products get out there and that we get to benefit from local businesses.
Thank you, Ms. Clément. Ms. Kennedy.
The Green Party believes that small businesses are the backbone of any community. And so therefore, we do believe in helping small businesses. And one of the ways that we are going to do so is with a green venture capital fund to help start green businesses. But not just for green businesses, we also want to look at helping small businesses with their paperwork, because it seems that agencies, the different federal government departments that they might have to deal with, there's paperwork from one, there's paperwork for the other, there's paperwork for another one, and they never talk to each other so that they can cut down on the paperwork and make it simpler. We also believe that any new legislation should be looked at from the point of view of what is the impact on new legislation on small businesses. We also believe that there's too much bailout for large companies with no guarantees of jobs.
Thank you, Ms. Kennedy.
One of the frustrating things about this is hearing over and over again these statistics that get thrown around about 1.3 million net new jobs. The unemployment rate in Canada last month was 8.7%. Before the recession, it was 6.2%. You cannot talk about adding jobs when the unemployment rate is 2.5% higher than it was when the Conservatives took power. So just to keep those kinds of things in perspective.
If I can just introduce some facts here, I don't believe that the unemployment rate, even through the world's worst global recession in 70 years, ever reached 8.7% in Canada. Now, if you want to talk about what we've done for small business, I think it's pretty interesting to know that we have managed to lower we are planning to lower the corporate tax another 20%. In other words, the payroll tax. My colleagues and I have been knocking on many doors, and I'm sure they'll agree that they've knocked on many business doors like I have. And you know the first thing that comes up to the business, are you folks going to introduce this $1,000 payroll tax like the province is planning on doing? And I unequivocally say, no, we will definitely not. And I think the other parties have to decide here tonight, maybe, whether they and their party will introduce that $1,000 corporate tax, retirement tax for that added CPP, supposedly. And I happen to know that one party will do that, that's in their platform, and another party is seriously thinking about it. So it would be interesting to get clarification if that, because you know what? That is going to cost us thousands and thousands of quality jobs.
Lowering corporate taxes does not help stimulate the economy. Recently, it was shown by the governor of the Bank of Canada that we have hundreds of billions of dollars in dead money sitting in corporate bank accounts. They just take the tax breaks and put it in the bank. So what's the point of constantly giving them these tax breaks?
So the question is on small business, and Cornwall has quite a number of good small businesses. And when I talk to them, they need help with networking, they need help with mentors, they need help with connecting with each other and connecting their products to the markets. And so that's what we need to be focusing on, is supporting small business in their goals.
Thank you, Ms. Clement. We'll wrap it up there. Thank you all. The next question, this is a hot topic right now. The proposed Trans-Pacific Partnership, or TPP, if you will, is causing concern with poultry and dairy farmers that the current supply management may be undermined and offshore competition will severely impact farmers. Because both of those sectors are prominent in the United Counties, what would you do to ensure that our farmers are protected? And we begin here with Mr. Lozon.
Okay, Dan, I beg to differ with your assessment that the supply managed folks are not in agreement with TPP. They are ecstatic about TPP. As a matter of fact, the heads of the Canadian Dairy Farmers of Canada has come out and endorsed TPP, as has the head of the Poultry Association of Canada. They've endorsed it. TPP gives us access to $27 trillion in economy that we can go out and we can market to. We're a country of 35 million people. We're going to have 800 million people we can sell to. Canada's going to boom like never before because of the TPP. That's what we want. We want more jobs and more economy.
I haven't met any ecstatic dairy farmers in a while, sir. I don't know where you've met ecstatic dairy farmers. The last time I saw some dairy farmers, they were actually protesting in Ottawa with their cows on Parliament Hill, so I don't think they were ecstatic. Now, a Liberal government obviously believes in trade. We have neighbors, and that's what we do. We trade with our neighbors. But we have to make sure that we're protecting supply management. It is the system that works the best, that gives us best quality milk, and so we have to make sure that that's protected. Now, apparently there's going to be a compensation package. What I'm hearing from dairy farmers is, can we trust that this compensation package is going to work, and how are we going to plan for the future with a compensation package that we don't have any information about or any detail about?
Thank you, Ms. Claymont. Ms. Kennedy.
My real concern is about how this affects neighbors. You have a dairy farmer with a beef farmer as a neighbor. They're going to be locking heads with each other because one is going to get help, the other is looking forward to the TPP. Until we see the draft and the real wording of this TPP, I think we have concerns. But the other thing that concerns me about the fact that we haven't seen the draft yet is that it's known that there are several big companies, and I could list them off, that have already had access to the text, whereas our democratically elected people, such as Mr. Lozon presently, and or us as citizens, we have not seen the draft, but there's big companies, especially in the U.S., who have seen this draft.
Thank you, Ms. Kennedy.
Dan,
Mr. Berger.
If I was a dairy farmer, I'd be worried about the TPP and what's been announced. The fact that a $4 billion compensation package has been announced shows you just how much of a hit their industry is going to take. That's a huge number. And the question is, will they actually get this money? We're seeing what we saw this year in an election year, that the Conservatives have just announced a balanced budget. What they did, or a budget surplus, and what they did to do that was claw back money from different federal departments, including Veterans Affairs, $1.13 billion. So what's to stop them from clawing back some of this compensation package at some point? And one of the most disturbing things about the whole thing is that supply management has been undermined the whole time. There are trucks coming across the border from the United States that are being not tariffed like they're supposed to be. And a farmer in Avonmore told me the other day that they estimate that 90 trucks a week are crossing the border without tariffs, and they should be tariffed to protect supply management.
Well, it's now open.
Dan, with all due respect to my colleagues, I want to give you a little history lesson here. The Conservative Party of Canada, this riding association right here in 2006 was the instrument. We put in the Conservative Party of Canada is the only party that has the guarantee of supply management in their policy. The Prime Minister Harper is the only Prime Minister that ever supported supply management from the floor of the House of Commons, as is Jerry Ritz, who is an agricultural minister. No one on this stage has a more intimate, long-lasting relationship with dairy farmers than Guy Lozo. And I can tell you, I've been with those farmers from day one, and each and every one of them, and they told me without, you're going to have to clarify, because I know the head of the local Dairy Farmers Association, when I said, you know what, I was so proud that for 10 years we didn't have any tractors on Parliament Hill. He said, Guy, I can guarantee you, none of our guys were up there. Thank you.
Mr. Harper's Conservatives were not the only ones to support supply management. That is not true, sir. And the other thing about supply management is that it has taken additional hits, not just under TPP, but under the European Union agreement, CETA, from last year. So there's already been a hit on supply management, and we don't even know how that's going to be factored in. And now we have a TPP hit on supply management. These things are compounding, and dairy farmers are worried. They're concerned. They're not ecstatic. And no, it is not correct to say that it's only one party that supported supply management. That's incorrect.
Exactly. We have it in our policy book as well. We're totally in support of supply management.
So are we.
So we'll wrap this one up here and move on to the next question. The final one from the moderator for you. We've talked about the FedDev funding. We've talked about infrastructure. We've talked about business taxes. We've talked about communication. Let's now boil it down to the local riding that whichever one of you is successful on October 19th will be representing. What projects will you work hard to bring to this particular riding? And we begin this one with Ms. Claymont.
So the big focus for this riding will be on infrastructure investment. We saw how we benefited from the wastewater treatment plant and the Benson Center. We need some improvements to Highway 138. So a lot of our health care, a lot of people in our community actually travel to Ottawa for health care. We need that 138 to be safer and more efficient. We also need better transportation corridors to our distribution centers. So our economy now depends a lot on those distribution centers. We need Marlow to be more efficient. You know, we also have infrastructure for housing, affordable housing. In this city, we have over 600 people on the waiting list for affordable housing. This is unacceptable. And an infrastructure program under a Liberal government will put immediate investment into building, not just legislation, into building affordable housing units for low-income and middle-income people.
Thank you, Ms. Claymont. Ms. Kennedy.
Can I talk about two?
The floor is yours.
Okay. First of all, one of the things that concerns me in our local riding, because I'm green, is the problem with windmills and our green technology. And one of the things I think we have to look at is the people that are concerned about wind technology, and a lot of it has to do because they don't know what's going on. There's all this secrecy about these big companies coming in, and we have to be able to discuss what's happening with the people that are in an area. Now, the other thing that I would also like to just make a comment about is that through the Council of Canadians, Canadian governments that I mentioned earlier, we also want to look at housing for seniors, First Nations, social justice people, and also affordable housing for all of these.
Thank you, Ms. Kennedy. Mr. Berger.
What I think is the most glaring failure of our current MP is the situation with Akwesasne at the moment, and I would make it a priority to fix that relationship. I was speaking to the Mohawk Council a few weeks back, and they told me they have no relationship with our current MP. This, of course, made it the border crisis that we had a few years ago a lot worse in that situation. There should have been dialogue. Why were those guards having to be armed in the first place? Our MP should have, if that was going to happen no matter what, our MP should have had the ear of Mr. Harper and was able to say to him, look, we need a transition period so we don't have traffic chaos in Cornwall and security risks as the cars are piling up on the bridge at the border check. So we definitely needed some leadership on that issue. We needed some cultural sensitivity. And what I think what we really need to do is have an MP that represents all the residents of this riding, and especially those who were here long before Canada itself was established. And any student of the War of 1812 knows that we owe the Mohawk a debt we can never repay.
Thank you, Mr. Berger. Mr. Lauzon.
I think the question was in regards to what we would do from an infrastructure perspective. In July of 2014, a delegation of municipal people came into Cornwall and were touring around the city looking at our infrastructure. And they said, how can you be so lucky? Everything, you've got this new bridge, you've got a new hospital, you've got the Benson Center, you've got new sewage treatment. It goes on, you've got new streets, new roads, new water mains, et cetera, et cetera. And you know what the city official said? The city official is quoted as saying on August the 1st, 2014, pointing to projects like the new low-level bridge and the Benson Center Sports Complex, the official said, there's more investment in the last handful of years than in the last 50 years. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Lozano. The floor is open.
So our economy is stalled now. And that's fine to talk about what's been invested, but we need to move forward. We need to be looking towards the future. And we still have aging infrastructure in this community. And you know, cities and municipalities provide 60% of the services, but we don't get 60% of the tax dollar. We need a strong federal partner at the table, and we need to be building affordable housing. Now, the other plans do not speak to immediate investment of the significance that the Liberal platform is proposing. And we have these needs now. Our route here, Marlow, that takes us to our distribution centers is at capacity. We need to be doing something about that. That's for our economy. Affordable housing, housing for seniors. What about arts and culture? We have a thriving arts and culture community here. And you know what? A Liberal plan will invest in social infrastructure, including cultural institutions and cultural buildings.
Actually, I think my colleague must have missed the announcement. The Marlow widening, Bernadette, we just 8 weeks ago announced $1 million to help with that.
We need more than $1 million.
Oh, yeah, but we did announce $1 million. By the way, you know, when a city official says that everything is, I can't believe it, it's better than it's ever been in 50 years, I think that maybe you need to get in your car, take a little drive around, and see what's happening. Because I'm going to tell you, our city, if you're talking about the city or the outlying areas, we have put three new sewage disposal plants in this riding. They're expensive. This one here costs $60 million, Iroquois costs $10 million, and I'm not sure what it costs in Morrisburg, somewhere around $10 million. We have put three of them in the last 5 years, plus the $75 million bridge, plus the Benson Center. I think we're doing more than our job.
Our asset management plan says we're falling behind, and we don't have the money as a municipality. We need a stronger federal partner at the table.
Thank you, everyone. We'll call it there on this one. And again, I want to remind you that you are watching the Chamber of Commerce All Candidates Debate on TVCOGECO. We're going to take a brief pause. When we return, we will take questions from our audience members here in attendance at the Civic Complex. Stay with us. Welcome back to the Chamber of Commerce All Candidates Debate on TVCOGECO. We've heard questions from the moderator, and now we're going to turn things over to our audience members here at the Civic Complex. A quick reminder, each audience member will get 30 seconds and no more, please, to ask their questions to a specific candidate, and that specific candidate will have 1 minute to answer the question. Just a friendly reminder that the quicker we ask our questions, the more questions from the audience members we can get to. So we'll begin with our first question from the floor. I'll just ask anyone who has a question. There are two microphones set up at the back of the room. If you want to get up and make your way over to those mics, that would be appreciated.
Mr. Lozo, as a teacher, I have a very big concern about all the cuts to transfer payments that have been made by our Prime Minister. And I'm very interested in knowing how it is that you're going to repair that relationship with our premiers, with our provinces. It's all been cut, and it's unnecessary, and it's been 8 years since he's met with our premiers.
Thank you for the question, because it gives me a chance to put some facts on the table again. There's a lot of misinformation that gets out in the public, and then after a while it's spun, and eventually people believe it. The truth of the matter is our Prime Minister has met more, much more frequently. I think it's almost twice as often with the premiers than any other prime minister. And there's no more gong shows anymore where everything is televised and everybody's trying to outdo each other. We have increased funding. We have increased funding to the provinces by 70% since taking government in 2009. 70% increase. Where you got the information that there was any decrease is totally unbelievable. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Lozo. Our next question, please.
My question is for Mr. Berger. My concern is on consistency of implementation of policy. Can you tell me how consistent the NDP would be on implementing their policies?
So our consistency will come from our dedication to balancing the budget. We will be very strict managers. The NDP has the best record of all the parties in balancing budgets. This is something that you can look up on Statistics Canada. So we will definitely implement policies. We will definitely be, because we have a very democratic and open and transparent nature within the party, that we will be very transparent and open in making sure that the policies that we put forward are being implemented. One of our plans is to always be in consultation with the kinds of groups that are involved. Our Alzheimer and dementia strategy, for example, we are going to be consulting with the Alzheimer Society, we are going to be consulting with seniors groups, and we will be consulting with the provinces and the municipalities for delivering these services.
Thank you, Mr. Berger. Our next question from the floor.
My question is for Patrick. Okay. How do you plan to, the next government, to deal with veterans instead of fighting, helping them? Can you explain me? Thank you.
Okay. So what we will do, I'll read from our stated policies. We're going to reopen the veterans' offices that were closed by the Conservatives, and we're going to expand health services for all veterans and their families. We're going to fix the Veterans Review and Appeals Board to ensure all veterans are treated with equality and respect and have access to the health care that they need. We'll improve the new veterans charter. One of the problems with that is these lump sum payments that they give to young soldiers that are in some cases suffering from post-traumatic stress disorder, and then they just spend all the money and then they've got nothing left. So we're definitely going to look at that. We're going to make it one veteran, one standard. We're going to end unfair reduction of pensions, and we're going to extend the Veterans Independence Program.
Thank you, Mr. Berger. Our next question from the floor.
In February of this year...
Who's the question for, please?
The Liberal candidate. In February of this year, the Supreme Court of Canada struck down a law against assisted suicide and physician end-of-life care and gave the government a year to come up with alternate legislation. It will be a free vote, so we all know what your party policies are. You know, I know, but you will have to vote according to your conscience. I'd like to know if you will vote on legislation that reflects the spirit and the letter of the Carter decision.
This is a very sensitive topic, and thank you for the question. We want to study this. The Supreme Court has given us an outline of what they want us to do and make sure that we're going to be respecting the charter. But we now need to consult and have discussions. So my opinion, your opinion, everybody's opinion has to matter here in terms of how we move forward. So we want to put a committee together to make sure that we're doing proper consultation with communities, and not just physician groups or patient groups, but people from the community who have strong faith groups, who have strong ideas and strong thoughts about this, and then we'll have that discussion and move forward. The Supreme Court has given us a year. That year is almost up. We should have been looking at this. The Conservative government should have been looking at this before the clock is ticking. And so now that the clock is ticking, the Liberal government will get right on this, do a committee, and then we'll have to have full engagement with communities on this topic.
Thank you, Ms. Claymont.
Okay, thank you.
Our next question from the floor.
Hi. I'd like to address this to the Green Party candidate or anyone who would be interested in...
Okay. Go Green.
Green Party candidate, please. So based on statistics, our young people have become more apathetic and disenfranchised in politics and the democratic process than ever before. Politicians always say that young people are our future, but based on the crippling amounts of student debt, the exorbitant price of childcare, and the availability of good-paying jobs with pensions and benefits.
Question, please.
My question is, what are you doing to inspire, assist, and understand those who will be taking care of you one day, our young people?
Okay, first of all, we certainly believe that young people should go into the job market after having, whether it's college, university, or apprenticeship training, without huge debts to burden them for, in some cases, many, many years. And so one of the things that we're going to do is by 2020, abolish tuition fees, but immediately cut fees for tuition fees for low-income people. We also want to eliminate any existing debt over $10,000 and abolish interest on student loans and increase funding for bursaries, because we believe that the young people are our future, and right now they seem to feel that they have no say in it, and so therefore one of the things we also want to look at is proportional representation, so that everybody feels they have a say in what's happening with their government.
Thank you, Ms. Kennedy. Our next question from the floor.
Just, Mr. Moderator, this requires a yes or no answer, and I would appreciate if all of them the candidates could answer. It would suggest a yes or no answer, okay?
Right, as long as all the candidates agree, it's a yes or no answer. Right?
I'm sure they will.
Okay.
If the request
you got 30
is
seconds.
In June 18, 2009, Liberal MP Ruby Dallas' private member bill was introduced, and the purpose of it was to amend the Old Age Security Act to reduce the residency requirement for the entitlement to a monthly pension from 10 years to 3 years for new Canadians. Fortunately, this bill did not become law. However, Liberal MP Bob Ray and other NDP MPs
question,
keep trying
please.
To introduce. I got to do the preamble. The estimate cost is over $700 million. If this bill is ever reintroduced, will you support it?
Yes or no?
Yes.
No.
Yes or no? Thanks, Glenn Grant.
Okay, Ms. Kennedy?
Yes.
Yes.
All right, next question from the floor.
Questioner for addressing the question to all four candidates. I'm disappointed that the single biggest issue that I feel that is before us at the moment, which is climate change, has not been touched on. I would hope that the four candidates would divide the answer time in four, and each of you give us what your party would do to address the growing threat of climate change.
Well, thank you for your question. Here's what we're going to do for this one. We're going to give you all 30 seconds, okay? Is that fair?
Mm-hmm.
We'll begin with Mr. Berger.
So this has been, of course, a huge step backwards for Canada, always being a leader in international issues, the climate change issue. We've known about this since the 60s. It's been going on. When the Liberals signed Kyoto, it looked like there was a glimmer of hope that we'd actually do something. Of course, they did not do anything. They set no standards or anything like that. The Conservatives used that as an excuse to walk away from Kyoto entirely, putting Canada like on the complete offside of the most important issue probably in our time. This is a huge priority for us. We will get Canada back on track with the international community. We will set standards, a cap and trade system.
Thank you, Mr. Berger. Mr. Lozon, 30 seconds.
Our government will continue to implement a responsible sector by sector regulatory approach that is aligned with our major economic competitors, like the United States, to ensure that Canada's economic competitiveness is protected along with the environment. In 2013, Canada's GHG emissions were 3.1% lower than 2005 levels. Now, the previous government signed Kyoto, and then 5 years following Kyoto, greenhouse gases increased 38%.
Thank you, Mr. Lozo. Ms. Claymont, 30 seconds.
You know who's showing the greatest leadership in terms of climate change is the provinces. So places like BC, like Ontario, and like Quebec have actually gotten together because there has been an absence of federal leadership. So Justin Trudeau and a Liberal government will work with the provinces to design a plan that will reduce carbon emissions and actually take leadership from the provinces and work with them. The other piece that will benefit this riding is green infrastructure. So we have a lot of land here that is polluted, and green infrastructure will allow us to invest money into cleaning up properties and renewing infrastructure for Cornwall.
Thank you. Ms. Kennedy.
Our carbon fee and dividend plan is the smartest, most efficient, and most effective way to shift away from burning fossil fuels. We will place a fee on carbon and pay the funds it generates directly to every Canadian over age 18 in the form of an annual carbon dividend. This plan will defend our climate, diversify our energy mix, grow our economy, and ensure energy security for Canadians.
Thank you, Ms. Kennedy. Before we go to our next question, I know we kind of divvied from the schedule just to let everyone answer, but we have a lot of people waiting in line, so we're going to stick to one candidate, one question, back to the 30 seconds in a minute so we can get through them all. Okay, next question.
My question is for the NDP candidate. I'm interested in knowing what the NDP policy is on seniors, predominantly in terms of care and senior care and their caregivers.
Okay, thank you. So one of the issues with seniors care is that there's not enough home care, there's not enough long-term care. 14% of acute care hospital beds are actually filled by seniors, and they have wait times of up to 230 days, and only a fraction of Canadians have access to palliative and end-of-life care, only 16 to 30% depending on where you live. So what we pledge to do is we want to invest $1.8 billion over 4 years. We want to support stronger home care, more nursing home beds, and better palliative end-of-life care. We see that our plan would give home care services to 41,000 more seniors. They will help provinces build 5,000 more nursing home beds. And what we also want to do in terms of the caregivers is that we want to make sure that people who are giving care have support. So what we want to do is we want to the compassionate care benefits that the Conservatives agreed to extend from 6 weeks to 6 months, we want to increase the eligibility for that so that more people can take care of people at home.
Thank you, Mr. Berger. Our next question from the floor, please.
Question for Bernadette regarding the role of an independent parliamentary budget officer. It was a brilliant idea when it was introduced by Mr. Harper to have some independent oversight. And subsequent to that, the parliamentary budget officer we had was starved of information. He would have to go scrounging outside the country sometimes, go to court, and would be ridiculed personally for his
reports.
Question,
please.
Your role in a Liberal government, what would you see as the role of an independent parliamentary budget officer who might give reports that you don't necessarily agree with?
That is a crucial role. I've been listening to Mr. Page. He's just written a book, and he's talked, and you've read it, and he's talking about that. So under a Liberal government, it is to make it truly independent and answerable to Parliament, not to the Prime Minister. And that's the difference. We have a Prime Minister who's in office now who's controlling everything and making everything political and strategic. A parliamentary budget officer is to be independent. Not only that, but in the next election, what we'd like to have is the parliamentary budget officer actually review each of the platforms independently to give the Canadian public during a campaign election a review of the costing of these plans.
Thank you, Ms. Claymont. We go now to our next question from the floor.
Ma question s'adresse à Bernadette Lamont, du Parti libéral. On sait que nos jeunes vont dans les universités et cégep, ils doivent quitter la région. Malheureusement, lorsqu'ils ont terminé leurs études, ils ont beaucoup de difficultés à chercher ou à trouver du travail. Quel est le plan du Parti libéral et de Bernadette Lamont si vous êtes porté au pouvoir le 19 octobre? Merci.
Merci pour la question en français. Alors, je vais répondre en français et en anglais. Monsieur Trudeau a annoncé justement qu'on veut augmenter le montant qu'on donne aux étudiants, et non seulement aux étudiants à faible revenu, mais les étudiants de la classe moyenne qui n'ont pas, sont pas admissibles à des prêts à cause du revenu de leurs parents. Alors, c'est pour augmenter les prêts. Et aussi, on veut insister que l'étudiant n'ait pas à repayer le prêt tant qu'il ne gagne pas 25 000 $. So a student who has not yet started to earn $25,000 should not have to repay. And under a Liberal government, the government will cover the interest rate on that and not require a student to pay until they're earning $25,000. Because with youth unemployment being 13.1%, it's very hard for young people to have full-time employment or part-time employment that gives them enough access to money to pay down debt.
Thank you, Ms. Clément. Our next question from the floor.
My question is for Bernadette Clément. Although there was no hue and clamor, as far as I knew, the Harper government decided to do away with the long-form census. And I believe that was a dumb move. I think even the conservatives at this point think it was a dumb move. What are you going to do to get that information that you got from the long-form census to recoup that and use it for your policies?
Thank you for that question. Simple answer, bring back the long-form census. If I'm standing on this stage today, running again in 2015, because I was a candidate in 2011 and it was tough. It's a hard thing to do to stand up here. We all know that. But it's worthwhile. And when I saw four more years of Mr. Harper affecting scientists, muzzling scientists, and doing away with science-based evidence, I got mad. And I said, I can't sit this election out. And so that's why I'm here. That's one of the major reasons why I'm running again, is to bring back the long-form census so that we're making long-term decisions. Yes, politicians should be making long-term decisions, not 4 years, 10 years, 20 years. Long, and planning for the future, and we need data and evidence for that, and we need the long-form census for that information.
Thank you, Ms. Clément. We have another question from the floor.
My question is for Guy Lauzon. I'm a digital education researcher and teacher in schools, and I see young people online a lot and using their digital identities, and the trade deal with the TPP seems to show a clause where our internet providers are going to be able to give our information about our digital usage and IP information for free without any need or security clauses question with that. Please. So why is the TPP such a great deal for us?
Well, I dare say that I doubt very much that the people who are working or doing, making, tweeting on the internet or whatever, are really know the details of the TPP, because quite frankly, the TPP is a deal between 12 countries. It's probably in translation as we speak. It has to go through all the legal people before it gets approved for publication. So I think the information that you received over the internet is probably inaccurate. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Lauzon. We'll go to the next question from the floor, please.
My question is for Bernadette Clément. With respect to Mr. Trudeau's recent announcements about the infrastructure spending, and pretty well, I'm going to be giving money away on a weekly basis. How do you reconcile that he's going to spend $135 billion in infrastructure spending with moderate increases of $10 billion for only 3 years? Where's the additional $105 billion going to come from?
It's $10 billion per year. Thank you for the question. It's $10 billion per year for the next 3 years. And the Liberal plan has a plan to make sure that that amount is audited, so we're going to be accessing the Auditor General to make sure that it remains in that modest category of $10 billion per year for the next 3 years, with a balancing of the budget 4 years from now. So it's not these numbers that are being bandied about by the Conservative. And the point of that kind of investment is to kickstart the economy. These are modest deficits. By the way, Conservative government had 7 deficits in a row. 7. So, and miraculously, in an election year, it's erased. I wonder how. Maybe through surpluses that didn't go to veterans when they should have. So this is a modest deficit. We know that deficits make sense when we're investing in long-term infrastructure.
Thank you, Ms. Clément. We go to the next question from the floor, please.
Hi there. My question is for Mr. Berger. As Bernadette mentioned, scientists are being muzzled right now in regards to announcements of research findings, cuts to funding for research facilities and whatnot. Cornwall is so fortunate to have a great research center in the St. Lawrence River Institute.
Question, please.
I'm just wondering what your views are on that and if you have any actions to kind of empower and encourage the dissemination of scientific knowledge in our community.
Thank you for the question. So this muzzling of scientists, this suppression, particularly of environmental data, I think is the biggest scandal of the Conservative government, that they're basically trying to cover up the fact that climate change is real. They've ordered Environment Canada to destroy data. All of this is just not acceptable. As far as the River Institute goes, I think they do wonderful work. And in fact, today a newspaper asked me for my position on the fact that the city of Montreal was going to be spewing 8 billion liters of raw sewage into the St. Lawrence. And so I asked the River Institute what they thought of that and what the impacts were. So I would go to the scientists, I would go to get an informed decision, and I know that Mr. Mulcair, as a previous environment minister, he definitely wants to have all the facts on the table.
Thank you, Mr. Berger. Our next question from the floor, please.
My question is for Mr. Lozon. Mr. Lozon, when your constituents, the citizens of this city, large part, were made aware of the tank farm or the proposed tank farm at the time, did you not stand up as a member of parliament, put your seat on the line to say to your government, this project is wrong and it needs to be changed?
Yes, what? You don't need to respond. That was not a question, so thank you very much. Next question.
Next question is Mr. Lozon is very proud of his government's job creation and projections. In fact, they project 1.3 million jobs created by 2020. This number is not low according to the Canadian Centre for Policy Alternatives, who's predicting between 1.8 and 2.6 million Canadians aged over 15 will
Question,
be entering
please.
The job market. I'm going to get into it. Entering the job market by 2020, given that there's a shortfall between your job creation number, his job creation numbers, and what the new people entering the workforce is, what would a Liberal government do to improve upon the dismal job creation record?
So the main issue is around youth unemployment. That number is double the regular unemployment rate, and that is of concern. It's of concern to this riding. You know, in my opening statement, I said, do people really believe that their children are going to be able to stay in this riding and raise their families here? Not with unemployment rates, youth unemployment rates that we have now. So the platform has a focus on youth unemployment, encouraging employers to hire young people and actually giving them incentives so that they do that. And creating co-op jobs, additional co-op jobs, so that young people can leave post-secondary and actually get some experience, and creating pre-apprenticeship programs and making it easier for students to deal with debt after their post-secondary. So the focus of the Liberal plan around employment is around youth employment and making sure that young people start working as soon as possible after post-secondary.
Thank you, Ms. Clément. Next question from the floor.
My question is towards Mr. Lozon. I was wondering, I drive by the chemical storage tanks on a daily basis on my way to school. So I was wondering, what is your opinion on what would do if you are reelected? What would you do with chemical storage tanks?
You drive by, I'm sorry, I didn't hear. You drive by?
The school bus route that I take, I pass by the chemical storage tanks on a daily basis and the Cornwall Harbor. So I was wondering, what is your opinion on what you would do if you were reelected? What would you do with the chemical storage tanks?
Regarding the Cornwall Harbor, the storage tanks? Okay, thank you for the question. As I mentioned, the storage tanks are there, and unfortunately, they're there, they're legitimate. And I've already talked a number of times with the principals who own, and they actually tried to beautify it. I have some photos, if you want to see after, of what the storage tanks actually look like in other sites. And apparently the city council didn't have the benefit of these photos when all this took place. However, They tried to grow grass there, and for whatever reason, there's too much sand in the soil. So he's apparently going to do it. I haven't been down there in the last week. I'm not sure if there's new grass been growing, but he said that he would grow grass and shrubbery, etc. This could be, as these pictures indicate, a rather nice sight. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Lozo. We have time for one more question from the floor.
Ma question s'adresse à la candidate libérale. One of the things that worries me the most about Canada's future is the credibility that my generation sees in our governing structure. Youth, and especially young adults, especially in this riding, need to get more involved in the decisions being made impacting their future. What does your party have in mind to change this current culture and get us involved in politics? Merci.
Thank you for that question. The saddest thing that happened to me in this campaign was knocking on a young woman's door a couple weeks ago, about 18, 19, saying she wasn't going to vote, that her vote didn't matter, that it didn't count. And I don't think I was able to convince her to go and vote. And that was a sad moment. The Liberal Party wants to have an open government and have proportional representation studied and have ranked ballots studied and have and just open the doors and sort of say, okay, this isn't working. Let's see how we can engage youth. We want to have a youth council as well with 16 to 24 year olds directly advising the Prime Minister. So we have a Prime Minister material in Mr. Trudeau, who is young, open, and who wants to review things so that we bring young people back into the fold. We need you to be voting. It's not going to work if we don't have the youth voting.
Thank you, Ms. Clément. So that wraps up our questions from the floor. We're now going to move to closing statements from each candidate. And we will do that in reverse order from which we started. So we will begin with Ms. Kennedy.
I would like to thank the Chamber of Commerce for organizing this forum and giving us all an opportunity to listen to you and for you to hear us. I encourage you to check my Facebook page for my comments on issues and check our Green Party website to search on topics that interest you and especially ones that I haven't been able to answer tonight. We Greens start with a vision of the society we want. Looking at each issue, we ask, does it advance the common good? Does it advance global peace and security? Does it address the needs of children? Does it ensure Canada's continued quality of life and economic health? Does it make families more secure? Does it protect, enhance, and restore the life support systems of the planet? Does it promote systems, cultural, institutional, and technological that are resilient and capable of adapting to shocks in a more unpredictable world? Our platform is based on four pillars: sustainable economy, because tomorrow is a serious business; strong communities, because Canada depends on it; good government, because it's time to restore democracy; bold action on climate, because we live here. We believe in sound fiscal management, fostering small business and strengthening our economy while ensuring it is sustainable. Does that mean we are right wing? We believe that government must provide needed social services while protecting our environment and the rights of women, minorities, and disadvantaged people. Does that make us left wing? We are neither. We are just the party of the future. The Green Party holds a positive view of Canada now and into the future. You have a choice, and I hope the Green Party is the one that you choose. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Kennedy. Ms. Clément.
Thank you. Merci to the Cornwall and Area Chamber of Commerce. I can feel it in this country and in this riding, a strong desire for new leadership that is focused on the future. Canadians have grown tired of this Harper government that dictates its agenda by stuffing our mailboxes all year round with pamphlets without any true consultation. This Harper government knows only one way to govern, and that's with a grudge. This government with a grudge means that instead of meeting with premiers to deal with the problems that we face, Mr. Harper picks fights with them. How can we solve things if our federal government practices the politics of division rather than unite us with a greater vision? The Harper solution to everything is to say cut taxes and everything else will trickle down and take care of itself. But that hasn't actually worked. And it has led to cuts in services that Canadians really need. Our economy is stalled, youth unemployment remains high, and services for veterans are cut in breach of our sacred obligation to them. Nous avons tellement besoin d'investissements dans nos infrastructures communautaires. Justin Trudeau's approach is a well-designed plan that economists have applauded, including David Dodge, the former governor of the Bank of Canada. The Liberal approach involves proper, necessary investment in infrastructure and actually meeting with provinces, municipalities to strengthen our economy and our healthcare and work on pressing issues. It's not about small government. It's about truly governing a big, bold country like Canada. If you believe, like me, that we can do much better, that our future can be brighter, then join with me to bring real change. Please vote Liberal on October 19th. Je suis prête à être votre député fédéral. I'm ready to be your MP.
Thanks, Ms. Clermont. Thank you, everybody. Mr. Lauzon.
Thanks, Dan. J'aimerais remercier la Chambre de commerce pour organiser ce débat ce soir. Folks, I've participated in 6 federal election campaigns, and I believe this is probably the most important one. We have a clear choice in this election. We can go down the Liberal and NDP road with huge tax increases, massive deficits, and no plan to balance the budget. Justin Trudeau is promising billions and billions of dollars in spending. His plans have major gaps for paying it all. Who do you think will pay for it? The Liberal plan will mean more debt, more spending, and more strain on businesses. The other option is my commitment and our party's commitment to you. That is simple and straightforward. We will continue to lower your taxes. We know that when local residents and businesses get to keep more of their hard-earned money in their pockets, our local economy and businesses prosper. Every day I hear from businesses that they can't afford the taxes, paperwork, and red tape, and the huge hydro bills of the Ontario Liberals. We cannot let Justin Trudeau or Tom Mulcair do the same at the federal level. It would be devastating and job losses would be massive. Up to 250,000 well-paying jobs are on the line, according to some reports. On October the 19th, I am asking you to re-elect a hard-working MP that loves his job and is proud of delivering results for you. Let's keep SD and SG and Canada moving forward. And as the PM always says, God bless Canada. Thank you. Merci.
Thank you, Mr. Lauzon. Thank you, everybody. Mr. Berger.
So on October 19th, you can vote for a party that will fund $1 million a day childcare spaces, a party that will reverse the cuts to health care, a party that will put in place a cap-and-trade system for greenhouse gases in consultation with the provinces, that will lower the retirement age, raise the guaranteed income supplement, and fund home care. A government that will repeal Bill C-51. A government that will promote agriculture as the driver of the economy. A government that will restore veterans' fundings. A government that will fund our cultural institutions like the CBC, Radio-Canada, and the Canada Post. A government that will treat our First Nations with the respect that they deserve and deal with them on a nation-to-nation basis. Or, you can vote for a party that flat out lies about the economy and the environment and tries to scare you, or for a party with a solid track record of making promises that they always break. But you can count on the NDP under Tom Mulcair. He's a principled and experienced leader dedicated to improving the lives of Canadians. So when you're in the voting booth on October 19th, remember that the NDP stands for freedom, and when you vote for freedom, you will always be free.
Thank you, Mr. Berger. So that concludes tonight's All Candidates Debate. I want to thank all 4 of our candidates, everyone in attendance for their questions this evening. Hopefully this All Candidates Debate and the local riding has been helpful for those of you who are undecided and maybe move you a little bit closer to an informed decision come October 19th. But we would implore you on behalf of the Chamber, on behalf of TVCOGECO, and on behalf of our 4 candidates here, we would really appreciate it if you went and exercised your right to vote on October 19th. Thank you for joining us tonight. I'm Dan Allaire, your moderator. And remember, October 19th, exercise your right to vote. Thank you.